I hope you all enjoyed getting a chance to sort of break out and break down what the tenets of conservatism are. And now we have a chance to engage with our president, Ron Robinson, on what you chose and why you chose them. Ron Robinson has served as the president of Young America's Foundation for more than 3 decades. He's led the foundation to many landmark victories in front of the Supreme Court, including for students' rights. He's also the man responsible for Young America's Foundation's National Conservative Student Conference for college students and our National High School Leadership Conference, which is an opportunity I hope you'll all take advantage of this summer. We also all owe our being here this weekend to Ron, whose successful leadership and guidance allowed Young America's Foundation to save and preserve President Reagan's beloved Rancho del Cielo. Recently, Ron received the Annie Taylor Award from the David Horowitz Freedom Center. You'll hear from David Horowitz later today during our lunch. That award is given to people who exhibit great courage by going over the ledge when others would be afraid to even go near it. Ron is a member of the Virginia and U.S. Supreme Court bars and resides with his wife, Michelle Easton, who serves as the president of the Claire Booth Luce Policy Institute in Reston, Virginia. I hope you learn everything you can from Ron this morning, and please join me in welcoming him.
Thank you, Spencer. Thank you very much. All right, good morning. Great to have you with us. Sorry I missed your introductions. I was actually at a foundation event in Arizona, but I normally like to hear you all saying hello and what you seek to get out of the conference. I'm going to make an assumption based on prior conferences, and I know there's some that attended prior conferences, that a number of you said that you want to strengthen your conservative beliefs or strengthen the conservative movement. So this morning we're going to focus on the question of what is the conservative movement? What are the beliefs of the conservative movement? But before I urge you to tackle that topic again, because you've done it in the small groups, I want to underscore why that is so important to understand the core philosophical beliefs of the conservative movement. And the basic reason is because inevitably leaders of the conservative movement, intellectuals in the conservative movement, either get ignored, which is probably the positive end of the equation, or they get trashed by the mainline news media and by culture. And if you're going to pass on your conservative ideas, you're probably not going to do it through an individual. You're not probably going to be able to just say, here's a leader that represents conservative point of view, because your fellow classmates are not going to know the strengths or weaknesses of that person. They're probably going to be vilified. And I'm going to try to show that to you by using some of the covers, particularly at Time magazine. The Time magazine editors admit that you can judge Time by its cover. They view it as iconic. So if you're quickly thinking you can't judge a magazine by its cover, at least the editors of Time and the editors of Newsweek would say, in fact, you can. I've had that discussion with them, and they would acknowledge that as something that they believe is the strength of their magazines. The editors of Time, which I gave this presentation to a number of years ago, said Time is the only place in the country where you can really hear both sides. That's just fair. They must be totally delusional if they really think that. So you have to keep in mind, this is what your fellow classmates are going to see on different people as they are presented. And some of these are a few years old, but they're representative. You'll see this pattern if you start paying attention to it going forward. Some of you have seen this presentation before, and you probably have had an opportunity to compare what I said about it or prior magazine covers with current magazine covers. And in fact, I believe I have in this presentation this week's cover of Time magazine. But basically, they begin with something like this. Liberals are portrayed, this was the John Kerry and John Edwards cover once they were nominated. Perfect smiles, the Sunshine Boys, very, very positive. To jump to a more current figure, Elizabeth Warren. No skepticism about Elizabeth Warren, how she got where she was by pretending to be a Native American, but just who's afraid of Elizabeth Warren, suggesting no one really should be afraid of her. Now, I like grandfather figures these days, but the next person is really portrayed as a friendly grandfather. I would like a cover like that. Bernie socializing, socialize this America. Very, very positive cover. If you saw this, you would probably come away thinking this is someone that you wouldn't mind knowing about. The next picture seems a little bit rough, but again, sometimes you just have to work with what you're given. But it's Supreme Court Justice Ginsburg, but she's an icon. So, she's on the court for her intellectual ability, not for her looks. But still, it's a positive cover. And I don't mean to be too negative on that. But this is again the treatment liberals generally get. The other very leftist Supreme Court justice is Justice Sotomayor. Again, smiling face, very positive. This is how generally liberals are presented to the country. Probably, if you look back, one of the dumbest leaders in the liberal movement has been Al Gore. For example, if you went back to his film, Inconvenient Truth, which was very popular 15, 20 years ago, he had predicted by this time that all of Florida would be underwater. Well, that prediction certainly seems to be far-fetched. But he is portrayed as the thinking man's thinking man, Al Gore's new plan for the planet. No critical look at his past. If someone's introduced on television from a liberal point of view, again, you get a great smile. You get a very positive puff piece. Current persons of the year, or person of the year, I guess it is persons of the year, depending on how you look at this, is time this year, is the silence breakers. Didn't have anything like this when women were coming forward in the Bill Clinton scandals, far from it, but this is portrayed as very positive. The Avengers, the same theme. Normally, you would think the Avengers would be a negative term, but in this particular case, it is meant as a positive one. Ripped apart the cost of America's immigration crackdown. So, you're never going to see on the cover of Time magazine any problems with illegal immigration, but you will see the problems with anything trying to enforce the law, a law that was put in place not by the current president, not even by the prior president, but the standing law of the United States for quite some time. You might be thinking of yourself as being free enterprise oriented, but your fellow classmates have probably seen covers like this that we're all socialists now. So let me turn to the conservatives. You've seen a sampling of what liberals are portrayed. I'm going to come back to some more with a President Obama, and I'll compare him with President Trump. But conservatives are like Pat Buchanan, who was President Reagan's communication director. He has been on the cover three times. He's a hellraiser. He's preaching fear, and he's a bully boy. So those are the way he's portrayed. Newt Gingrich, when he's on the verge of becoming Speaker of the House, was probably the happiest man in America. The Democrats had controlled the House of Representatives for more than 40 years. He was on the verge of winning an historic victory. If you were with Newt at that time, I guarantee you there was no one happier in the country. The week before that election, he was portrayed as mad as hell, looking like he was screaming at the American people. Before he even took the office of Speaker of the House, he was portrayed as Uncle Scrooge. It's the season to bash the poor. Is Newt Gingrich's America really that heartless? So that was Christmas season before he even became the Speaker of the House, but had been elected as that. Rush Limbaugh has been portrayed three times on national covers, all critically. I'll give you the opening one. Voice of America, Howard Stern and Rush Limbaugh with the screaming into the microphone, looking absolutely like a madman. You saw how the Democratic ticket was portrayed as Sunshine Boys. The Republican ticket that same year was the Avengers, taking aim at the age of Clinton. Ted Cruz is someone that I admire, certainly one of the smartest people in Washington, also from a minority background, so you would think they might portray him somewhat positively, maybe the future face of the Republican Party. But no, they found the most ugly picture of him imaginable. I didn't even recognize this picture when I first saw it, and I know Ted Cruz likable enough. So the suggestion is no one's going to like Ted Cruz. He looks like Uncle Fester, I think, in that one. This is a double whammy. Not only do they use a bad picture of Michelle Bachmann, a congresswoman for a number of years from Minnesota, someone who adopted 23 kids, raised a great family, has been a great leader and advocate of individual freedom around the country. They portrayed her as the queen of rage, using really not a very positive picture of her. It's not one of the full-blown smiles you see on other people. Governor Christie, I don't know what you think of Governor Christie. I'm not a huge fan of him, but I know a number of Republicans are. But speaking of huge, they portrayed him as the elephant in the room. So not many people are going to like the elephant in the room, right? Vice President Cheney, they had a theory that he had exposed, his office had exposed Valerie Plame as question over a deal to get uranium eventually into terrorist hands. They suggested some of the things he had done was illegal. None of that was true, that he had exposed Valerie Plame. In fact, she was exposed by Russian a spy working for the Russians. So the American intelligence community, as well as press, knew full well that she was not an active spy at the time. She had been exposed more than 5 years before. It was actually Richard Armitage, a liberal, who blew her cover. But they still wanted to stick with the story that was Vice President Cheney did that. So they put the verdict on Cheney with a cloud over him. Again, a totally, totally deceptive cover of Time magazine. I mentioned that Al Gore was kind of a joke, but really the biggest joke among recent vice presidents, of course, is Joe Biden. I don't know where to begin. He calls himself Lunchbox Joe. In the vice presidential debates, he cited a gritty restaurant that he goes to all the time. Unfortunately, it was closed years before. He's a guy that most people in Washington viewed as a joke, but Newsweek portrayed him why Joe is no joke. So you see these. Shift now to the presidents for a moment. When Barack Obama was first a state senator, not a United States senator, but a state senator in the state of Illinois, he was portrayed as seeing purple, a rising star who goes beyond red and blue. So purple is the person who has a chance to unite the entire country. He was portrayed well in advance of the election as the next president, although you can see the qualifier there why he could be, and in fact he turned out to be. There were more than 50 very favorable covers. He didn't have much experience, but when that happens to a liberal, you'll have a cover like this. How much does experience matter? How much does experience matter anyway if it's a liberal? Of course, when it was Donald Trump running for president, that was a very big issue. When he was elected, I would expect a very positive cover for the new president of the United States, and he got it, both from Time and Newsweek, so I don't have any problem with that. Why his critics are so dumb, that's you or your parents or the speakers you might have heard from yesterday or you might hear from the rest of the weekend. So if you're a fellow classmate of yours and you had criticisms of Barack Obama, the media is portraying you as dumb for even having criticism. You can have criticism of any president of the United States. Trust me, no president of the United States is perfect, even Ronald Reagan. If you press me in Q&A, if we have time, I'll tell you criticisms of Ronald Reagan. So it doesn't mean necessarily your critics are dumb in any way. Hillary Clinton, from the outset, when she was going to run for senator in New York, a state she never lived in, they portrayed her as her turn. She was, again, a very positive smile. Both Clinton and Obama received scores of extremely positive covers. Here's another one. Women of the Year. I think it probably should be Woman of the Year, but Women of the Year. What Hillary believes when people question whether she really had any strongly held opinions. I found my voice. Many, many positive ones. When they said she wasn't healthy enough or emphatic enough in what she believed, hear her roar. She was the fighter with, again, a great smile portraying her as someone very positive. Furthering the point, Hillary Clinton and the rise of smart power. Again, you're not going to see anything like this for conservatives, suggesting that she ought to be elected as the first woman president. I'm going to use a version of what was said about John Kennedy, saying that she was the first woman in the White House. Heck, her husband had thousands of them. Shifting to our current president. How's this? He's giving you the finger there, out of the bad deal. That's a pretty clear definition of hostility, if there ever was one. I like this one. Bully, showman, party crasher, demagogue. They obviously didn't want to check off 45th President of the United States. That was March of 2016. So that's not something that he had just been elected. The portrayals of him are almost always negative. Deal with it. This was in August when he had received the nomination. Person of the year in after he got elected. Even there, not a smile, kind of looking, I don't know what it is. I mean, you won't see anyone else on the cover with their sitting in a chair looking backwards. I don't know what that's all about. But he had been elected president of the United States. You compare that with the happy and very attractive smile Barack Obama had when he was elected. Incoming, what does incoming mean? Anyone come from a military family, follow military history? What does incoming mean? Bombs, artillery usually. You're being shelled, suggesting that his coming to Washington is the equivalent of an artillery assault on the city, which actually may not be a bad idea. Trump's war on Washington echoes the same theme. This is the suggestion that he's detached from actually serving as president. This was very early on in the presidency. Of course, that has shifted now, saying that Trump has to control everything. But their initial take was that Trump really didn't worry about the details, that he really didn't care, just stuff was blowing by him. Why he always bounces back? This is a relatively favorable one, I suppose. There's a lot of ways you can portray him if a person bounces back, but that's not a completely positive one. But now we get to a repeated theme of Times covers when they were dealing with Donald Trump, basically suggesting that no one would support him. First was a meltdown, very negative. If your fellow classmates had seen that, you would have thought his campaign was over. But of course, his campaign wasn't over. He continued on. So then you had to have a total meltdown. So you just made sure you got the message. And along the same theme, they didn't know what to do. This was his summary of year one of his presidency, which was actually a year of considerable accomplishments. The wrecking crew. So, these aren't, you can see a constant theme that he's destroying, incoming, wrecking things. The Swamp Hotel, this is actually the Trump Hotel, trying to suggest that everyone in the country knew that Trump owned a series of hotels when he became president. But they have been relentless in trying to suggest that anyone that checks into one of those hotels is merely trying to buy influence, even though the president gave up all profits from anyone that was a foreign government or foreign thing and gave it to the United States, the Treasury of the United States. But they portray it as a swamp hotel. The White House is half the Kremlin. If you want to talk about collusion with Russia right now, there's no question there was collusion in the presidential campaign with Russia. The dossier on Donald Trump, which was put together by Fusion GPS, funded by the Democratic Party, put together by a foreigner, even though he was British, still illegal for foreigners to be involved in the presidential campaign. So when the Democrats funded a foreigner to do this work, they were breaking the law. And then they were using Russian sources that they colluded with. So if you want to talk about collusion with the Russians, there's no question that the Hillary Clinton and Democratic campaign colluded with the Russians. There's plenty of questions of whether there was any collusion from the Trump campaign with the Russians. Steve Bannon, who put together the films we have here in the center. There's a, I don't know if you've seen the film on the Reagan Ranch yet, but Steve Bannon was actually the producer of that. He was the CEO of the campaign in the closing weeks. And then at the White House, he's the great manipulator. The president's son is red-handed, like he's caught red-handed, either caught red-handed with his hand in the till or caught with working with the Soviets. The chief of staff is portrayed as Trump's last best hope. This was several weeks ago, as if Donald Trump, you know, in his first year of the presidency, is on his absolutely last chance to do anything good for the country. So what I would suggest to you is that your fellow classmates, when they see conservatives, they see them as people like this, manipulators. The president in a very, you know, negative light, or mad as hell. But liberals are always smart power. Our time for change has come. You know, very favorable portrayal of Elizabeth Warren. To paraphrase Will Rogers, he said, if you don't follow the news in our country today, you're ill-informed. But if you do follow the news in our country, you're misinformed. That's really what your classmates are facing. There are issues that you want to be concerned with, but if you rely on the mainline news media, you're going to be misinformed about what is the truth and what is going on. And this is why dealing with our principles is so important. Young people who pay attention to political questions only intermittently are going to get an impression based on these personalities and the way they're portrayed. In the end, you want to come back to the principles. What you're fighting for? What do you believe in your heart? Perhaps the way Babe Buchanan put it. Do you want to live in freedom? Or do you want someone in Washington to be making decisions for you? Those are the fundamental questions that really divide liberals and conservatives today. It's not the quality or caliber of the people leading either side. There's good people on the conservative side and good people on the liberal side. They may have the wrong ideas, but they may be good people, and there's bad people on both sides too. But the media relentlessly portrays conservatives in a negative light and relentlessly portrays liberals in a positive light. That is almost childish. It's something like when you read, you know, stories as a child of, you know, the big bad wolf against, you know, Goldilocks or something. It's just a dichotomy that doesn't really exist in the real world, but that's the way the liberals try to portray it. So let's go to the conservative principles. I see group four, group five. Which group was really group number one? Pat's group? You're group number one. So who's your representative? Why don't you come on up? Have you done this before?
I have not done this before.
Good. Good to have you with us.
Nice to meet you.
I think this works.
Hello, hello.
They'll turn it on. Is this your board?
This is my board.
Why don't you choose a couple of things that you think represent conservative ideas and what it means to you and okay. Your group.
Okay, we chose our top three. One of them is traditional values, so like hardworking, it's cord around the family.
He needs to hold it up, I guess, right? Or he needs to turn it on and hold it up, probably.
Hello?
There you go.
Hey, there we go.
You got the you got their attention now.
Got their attention.
Traditional values, like I said, the people are generally hardworking. It's quarter on family values and Judeo-Christian values. Limited government for more personal freedoms.
Okay, why don't you pick two? So. What is it about Judeo-Christian values that you think is essential to conservatism? You think liberals don't believe in Judeo-Christian values?
I believe it is more in our tradition to have Judeo-Christian.
So give me a contrast in that, if you will.
For liberals?
Liberals versus conservatives. Take the Ten Commandments. Does the liberals have a hard time with some of that?
Yes, for the pro-choice. It says, thou shalt not kill, and they're killing children in the pro-choice movement.
How about coveting? Thou shalt not covet?
See.
Is liberalism based around coveting?
Yes.
Is it based around envy?
Yes.
Your teachers tell you that, right?
No.
Yeah, okay. Just wanted to get some of those contrasts out. Well, talk about limited government. What does limited government mean to you?
One of the kids in the group described it as almost like a helicopter mom, where always watching.
That's not limited government, is it?
No.
That's unlimited government.
Right. Where they're always watching over you and you have less personal freedoms and you'd have less of a free market, per se.
A helicopter mom could fit under traditional values to some extent, but definitely when the government does it, it's not the same thing. Why isn't it the same thing when the government does it? Aren't they just as concerned about your welfare as your mother is?
yeah, but I'm really basing this off of one of the speakers yesterday.
Okay, yeah.
And
who was the speaker? I wasn't here.
Shoot, what was his name?
Bert Folsom?
Folsom.
Okay, good.
Yep. Yeah. So he said back in the age of where they were first inventing the first cars and the first planes, when the government tried to intervene in helping make the plane, it literally shot off a catapult into the water.
Yeah, something goes wrong with government doing it.
Yeah.
So traditional values, limited government. I'm going to talk a little bit more about limited government before I shift to the next board. Nuclear family. What is nuclear family? Does everyone know what nuclear family means?
Yes.
So there's a few no's. Do you know what it means?
Not necessarily.
Okay. Who knows? Yes. Why don't you tell us what it means in your words?
It's a family that's based on a man and a woman.
Yeah. Normally, it's considered a family based on two parents. In other words, it's not the village. It's not the village people. It's two parents usually, or the parents of the child. The nuclear family usually is your siblings. Although I grew up in a house with cousins too that were equivalent of siblings. I had three siblings and four cousins in the same house. But normally but I would consider that my nuclear family. So I had two parents, fortunate. Not everyone has two parents at home all the time. So whatever the core of that family is the unit that should have the biggest say over the education and the lives of the people in that house. More so than social services, local government, state government, federal government. The nuclear family basically is your core family. Whatever you go home to, most conservatives believe the ideal, you don't always achieve the ideal, is a mother and a father. My father was an orphan by the time he was 8, so and his nuclear family was somewhat different. So I don't say everyone had a mother and father with them all their time, but that is basically the definition of nuclear family. Has nothing to do with nuclear energy, by the way. So just to want to clear that, term's thrown out a lot. Anything else you want to say on those two topics?
No, I think I'm good.
Good. I want to talk about limited government for a second. Thank you very much. Good job. I appreciate it. Good to have you with us. Since limited government came up in the first session, I want to give you one set of arguments as compared to unlimited government, even when democracy is working. So I'm going to contrast something where you want to retain your decision making, even if a majority of people say you're completely wrong and they want to give it to government. And you can convince your fellow classmates by this analogy, in my opinion. Some of you have heard it before. I know you've heard it before. It's music. How many people here have from 10 to 500 tunes in whatever you're listening to, but no more than 500. How many have from 500 to 1,000? How many have over 1,000? Okay, look at that tremendous inequality, liberals would say. Why should he have over 1,000 and someone else have under 500? We need to rectify that. If a majority said that, I think you would all be offended. How many people want to go to, it's not Barbara Boxer, Senator Brown and Dianne Feinstein to lobby for the kind of music you want to listen to? You want to go to Washington, lobby for the kind of music you want to listen to? Or do you want to make that decision for yourself? You want to make it for yourself. How many people want the government deciding what bands ought to go out of existence, what bands come along? You know, if the government decided, well, you'd still have to listen to the Glenn Miller Orchestra or something like that. You know, the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, I don't, all the time, right? They're bigger, they might have more votes, their senators might have more influence. My point to you is in music, there's inequities. Who controls tickets? Who allows things to be published? You can use all the liberal arguments against freedom in those areas, but I would bet you there's not a young person in this country today that wants to turn over music to the government and have to go lobbying your congressmen and senators for your kind of music, your band, your record company, your particular number of tunes. That's the difference between unlimited government and limited government. Even when a majority might say otherwise, you're retaining those areas for decision yourself. One other argument for limited government. People in the left oftentimes say the country's becoming very divided and we disagree on everything. You're going to disagree on everything when everything goes to government. When government makes a decision for my health care, and they've canceled the foundation's health care policies four times since Obamacare came in, we don't get to make that decision for ourselves. We have to go to some meeting where liberals are shouting at us and taking away our rights in order to decide that what kind of health care we're going to have for employees at Young America's Foundation. There's no reason for government to take over that decision. What kind of light bulbs we use, what kind of water there is in our toilets, how much you put away for Social Security, how much you put away for Medicare and your retirement. These are decisions you're capable of making and you should be able to make. You're not capable of making whether the United States nukes Korea or not. The country has to have leaders to do that. But that's why we're not for no government, we're for limited government. But limited government reduces the division among American people. You can make decisions for yourselves. And music is a great example of it. All right, who's in group number two? I don't know if they call it groups. All right, who's Pat? Oh, you are, I'm sorry. Tell us your name.
I'm Stephen.
Stephen, welcome.
Thank you.
Do your group, what, give me a couple of issues in your group. Is your group Pat and Friends?
It is.
Did COIL dominate it?
Do you want us to move the board?
So you can if you like, sure. Good luck with it. Why don't you pick a couple areas that you thought your group thought was central that hasn't been covered already?
Okay. We believe that upholding the Constitution is probably the most important issue facing our nation today.
Okay, upholding the Constitution. All right, why is that? I'm going to look for a black marker here. Someone gives me a black marker, I'd appreciate it. I want to highlight what you're covering.
Okay.
So upholding the Constitution, why would you do that? Wasn't it put together by old white men who were slaveholders?
Yeah, we believe that the Constitution is the most important document in recent human history. It's the most free, it gives freedom to the most amount of people. It was very revolutionary for its time, hence the name Revolutionary War. And we believe that the First Amendment, especially freedom of speech and religion, is unique to America. There is no other country in the world that has the amount of freedom we have. And we put the Second Amendment because a lot of people ask conservatives, what's the most important amendment? And we believe that it's the Second, because the Second protects every other amendment. Without the Second Amendment, every other amendment could be taken away very easily. You look at Soviet Russia and Cuba, Venezuela, all these nations where the Second Amendment doesn't exist and neither do any of the other ones. So upholding the Constitution.
So where do you learn all these things? Where'd you learn all that?
Well, I go to a private high school, mm-hmm. private Christian high
and
school.
Do you have conservative teachers?
Yes, sir.
Good. All right.
Go and on. Then right. Also
just check in. Just check in. I thought maybe the also government schools had improved. That was
no. Also my parents. So we also believe in the 10th Amendment, giving the states the power, because we understand that a limited government is important. The more power the government has, the more they're able to abuse it and take advantage of the people. So giving the states the right to decide what's best for them, because California is very different from Tennessee or from Montana. So every state should have the ability and the decision to choose what's best for them.
And what would you say about the Constitution was put together by a group of white males that many of them were, or majority maybe, were slaveholders. What would you say to that?
Well, the interesting thing is, out of the signers of the Declaration, roughly only 16 of them were slave owners that wanted their slaves. The law back then, you were not allowed to give up your slaves until you died. So all these people like George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, they weren't able to release their slaves because the law wouldn't let them. They tried to change it, but the southern states wouldn't allow it because that's how they made their money. It's a horrible thing, but that's something that the left tries to use. Oh, it's a bunch of old white men.
Right.
Well, that's rather racist and sexist, and I thought you guys were against racism and sexism.
I've been accused of not being against that, so that's why. I would say the answer to that, I think your answer is very good. So if I can add just one layer to it, is everything your generation and the leaders of your generation have accomplished immoral because this generation in the last, since 1973, aborted 60 million children? Future generations may look at this generation, our generations, and say they had just as much a moral stain on them proportionately as earlier generations did for not abolishing slavery. But that doesn't mean every other decision you make in this generation is wrong or is tainted because of that. Or to give it to you another way, now over 30,000 people are killed every year on the roads. Through most of the recent years, it's been over 50,000. But how many do you want to drive? How many do you view as driving self-driven cars is not immoral? Now, there are differences in these decisions, but my point is, when a generation makes a mistake that subsequent generations correct, it doesn't necessarily mean that everything that was done by that initial generation is automatically tainted by that. It's the Ten Commandments is a good example. They're old, and there was slave holding worldwide at that particular time. Of course, we believe that to be, of course, given to us by God. But you wouldn't say that Moses' generation is to be dismissed because they included slavery in it. So that the concept doesn't necessarily rebut what you correctly pointed out at the outset. It was a very revolutionary document in the sense that prior governments believed that the king had the power, that whoever was most powerful had the power, and the people just had whatever rights that person bestowed upon them. But the founding fathers of the United States began with a different assumption. They began with the assumption that we have God-given powers and we have government only to protect those powers that we have, not that the government itself has. So you were right about the difference. What is the second issue you would pick up?
So we also believe that a strong national defense is vital to a country, because without strict borders and laws preventing illegal immigration, you don't have a nation.
You put immigration as part of the national defense.
Yes, sir.
And yet, this country was strong and defended itself when it had large immigration in other generations.
Well,
what's the difference now?
Well, recently, unfortunately, there was the attack in New York where I believe 15 people were run over by a terrorist in a truck. That terrorist came into the U.S. through the lottery system, which was completely abused.
Now, well, you can go back to 9/11. Those guys came in the country. They weren't proved to do what they came in the country for. So, they killed 3,000 people. So it can be a threat to the country if you don't know who's coming in.
Exactly.
And the people coming in do not have a sense of shared values. I think that's fair to say. But normally, when you talk about a strong foreign policy, do you remember the term Ronald Reagan used for it?
Trust but verify.
Well, that was with treaties. But he had a general, almost cliche. Anyone remember it?
Peace through strength.
Peace through strength was what it was. And the argument was, when the country was strong, we were not usually attacked. When the country was weak, that's when the United States was attacked. So at Pearl Harbor, for example, was the low point of American military strength. And therefore, we were vulnerable to attack then. Even the 9/11 attack came in a period where we thought we were enjoying the peace dividend from the end of the Cold War. And defense spending had been down, intelligence spending had been down substantially. So really, the core message of strong national defense is peace through strength. What's the implications for having a strong military and foreign policy to your individual freedoms if you're overseas? Have you thought through that issue? Do you want to travel overseas in your lifetime?
Yes, sir.
Do you want a country strong enough to protect you when you're overseas?
Yes, sir.
So that people won't kidnap you or something?
Yes.
This is one of the differences of libertarians. Libertarians sometimes are not for as strong a national defense. But if you have contracts and companies working overseas, if you don't want American property illegally seized that other countries initially allowed us to come in, you have to have a strong foreign policy, a strong national defense. If Americans are going to be able to travel freely throughout the world, most of you will have the opportunity to do that in your lifetime. You want a country strong enough that someone's not going to kidnap Americans and do what they will with them. That goes right back almost to the founding fathers, to Jefferson's days, in defending us from the Barbary pirates in North Africa. So you want to be strong enough to defend that. You've got immigration and strict borders. There are other reasons on the immigration policy that conservatives ought to be concerned with. There are a lot of conservatives that are pro-immigration. I've actually sponsored people legally coming to the United States. So the legal system is not the greatest, but it often is cited that the country was built by immigrants, but when the country was built by immigrants, the country was basically empty. And most of those immigrants came under the existing laws. So we're still always going to have, I think, a large number of immigrants in this country. Just the question is whether you allow people to jump the head of the line and whether you allow them to violate the laws right from the outset. Ronald Reagan was actually much more lenient on immigration, but of course the immigration issue was not as intense at that time when he was president than the recent presidents. It's not just President Trump. If you go back and look at the some of the statements of President Obama and President Clinton, they were much tougher, at least rhetorically, on immigration than the President Bushes were or Ronald Reagan was. The left oftentimes doesn't like to call them illegal aliens. They say that that's an unfair usage, but this is, again, the left manipulating language. You want to call them undocumented aliens. Or undocumented. What's the problem with calling them undocumented? Anyone? Yes.
That means that they are supposed to be there and they just don't have any documents to prove they are.
Well, that's another way to look at it. They could be there and they're supposed to have the proper documents. That's implied. But they have documents. It's just the wrong documents. They're just they have documents from another country. So don't let the left get away changing the language to use inaccurate language. The conservatives actually use the more precise and accurate language. Anything else you want to say about strong national defense?
I think the American First policy, like in the speeches yesterday, it's crucial. Putting America first, like we shouldn't be putting other nations first. Sure, we can help them, but helping America first will then in turn help every other nation.
I think that's a fair point. It's almost a core conservative principle personally. Take care of your own life first before you start running other people's lives. You don't want to run other people's lives anyway, but take care of yourself first. Anything else you want to say on either of those two before I let you go?
I believe that's it.
Good. Thank you very much, Seth. Good job. All right, so I guess Group Freedom is up next, although it looks like Freedom... Is that TH or is that an F? Did you write that?
Freedom. No, I did not write that.
All right, Jack. I'll let you off the hook on that one.
All right.
Does it look like that?
It does. It does look like an F. I can see it.
Okay.
Okay. Could I borrow the marker real quick?
Sure.
I'd like to circle some of our...
Choose two of your main topics, if you will.
Okay. Two of the main
ones. Haven't
been
covered already.
Okay. So a lot of what people have been focusing on were conservative values, and what we kind of focused on was conservative premises, like... What is the ultimate foundation, the maxims of conservatism for which all these other values are manifested? And so the first one was individualism. We felt that in the Enlightenment, the founders stressed individualism and individual freedom as opposed to the left's collective tyranny. So that would be the first premise that conservatives advocate.
So flesh out individualism a little bit more for me. Does this mean like rugged individualism? What does individualism mean to you as a practical matter today?
Sure, in the sense that the individual is more important than the state, that the individual, the individual's natural rights and negative rights as opposed to positive rights should come first, that you have...
Do you mean by negative rights as compared to positive rights?
Sure, absolutely. Okay, so negative rights are, according to conservative principles, are natural rights that accrue to you as a man. I have a right not to be murdered by
and
you.
And a woman, I assume, right?
Of course,
you're
and a woman.
A man, but,
right, and man in the sense of mankind.
Right, right.
Okay.
As Winston Churchill says, man embraces woman, right?
Right.
Okay.
And then positive rights are rights mainly of the left. That two examples of that is a right to health care and then freedom of education, in the sense that you have to encroach on the negative rights of another individual. So that could be private property. You have to take my money, my private property, and then extract that from me, encroach on my rights to then fund your own rights. So that
you
would
take
be positive
it from me,
rights.
You mean steal?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Absolutely.
All right. And originalism, what do you...
Sure. So Brandon really laid this out for us. Originalism in the sense that conservatives recognize human nature. We recognize that the predisposition of mankind is that of is that towards sin, while the left holds this more Rousseauian thought that man is born free but everywhere he's in chains, that human nature is somehow good, while conservatives more align with Locke and Hobbes in the sense that we need to create a limited government so that despotism is not the
So
end
now
result.
I see why you had TH instead of just a straightforward F, because you were bordering on theology and theory rather than just freedom, right?
Right.
And what is how does originalism then come down to the difference between the left and the right?
Sure. So it's the difference between their views on human nature in the sense that we regard it
as a practical matter then. So
sure.
Pull that forward. What would a leftist do differently than a conservative based on those two different assumptions?
Sure, a leftist would support a collective tyranny in the sense that they believe that in their unearned moral superiority that they could fix inequities, which they see as inequalities. So they would more support tyranny of others because they know better, because they know how to fix, they know how to essentially fix human nature, because they believe social institutions are the faults, that that it's nothing is innately wrong with humans. Mm-hmm. And then if you follow that to the nth degree, then you will undoubtedly end up in tyranny.
Okay. I appreciate it. You did a good job.
Thanks,
Thank you. Jack.
Kyle's kids? Are you serious? How did that happen? How'd you let that happen, Thomas?
Well, it took about 5 minutes to come up with our name, and then
Kyle suggested it.
No, and someone said, "Why don't we just be Kyle's kids?" And then Kyle was just like, he didn't approve it, but
well, that's good to hear. That's good to hear. Choose a couple that haven't been covered so far that your group thought was really important.
So I put the top three up there. We were debating those, so.
Constitution's been covered so much, so take God and patriotism. Take those two, if you would.
Okay, so we started out with God. So we believe that when you believe in God, you have a strong foundation, morality and values, and that is really important, because if you don't have a strong foundation, you cannot, you know, further proceed and further know what you do and don't believe in. So when you have a God or a faith that you strongly believe in, you grew up with a sense of morality and a sense of values that better your society. And we were debating the Constitution and patriotism for a long time. The reason why we put patriotism above our Constitution was because we believe that patriotism first came, and it did, and the Constitution followed. What we mean by that is when the early founding fathers had, you know, their strong sense of getting away from Britain, starting their own country, they didn't come here to make their own constitution. They came here to start something new. They came here because they love their freedom, they love their rights, and they just want to provoke that idea into the new world.
So they were looking for freedom. That's part of the patriotism?
I would say that does fall under patriotism.
Yeah. And their rights, you said. Mm-hmm. And how did they, where did their rights come from? From the King of England?
So the founding fathers believed that through freedom, we were supposed to have certain unalienable rights.
Why would they be unalienable?
We want them to be unalienable because we want every person to have them.
Right. But who else? Give me. Why? Why would they be unalienable?
Because in man's state of nature, he's born into freedom, and so these unalienable rights are secured by God. And then
right. They're secured. They come from God. Are you a philosophy major?
I'd want to be.
Yeah, I thought so, yeah. The rights come from God. So your two things are really tied. This was the question of American exceptionalism. A lot of times the other groups would say American exceptionalism. This concept of American exceptionalism really fits right with what you're talking about. The left oftentimes belittle American exceptionalism. Obama did. He said people in Britain think their country is exceptional. People in Greece think their country is exceptional. He was equating exceptionalism, American exceptionalism, with the idea that you're just proud of your country or that your country is special in some generic sense. That's not the core definition of American exceptionalism that most conservatives believe in. What American exceptionalism meant for the conservative movement and for the founding fathers was our rights did not come from the king. They were inalienable. They came from God. They were our rights, and no government could take those rights away from us. That we secured those rights by forming government, but it wasn't government giving us those rights. That's American exceptionalism. American exceptionalism was the first government, the first society that said our fundamental rights come from government and ordered that government around those God-given rights. So your concept of what the founding fathers viewed as patriotism that preceded the Constitution or even the Declaration of Independence ties back to your first point in their history and what they did. And so you have it absolutely right when you talked about freedom and rights. It goes back to their belief in a Judeo-Christian God that gave them those rights in their opinion. Fair enough?
Fair enough. Fair enough.
Kyle, you got to get this group, keep working at it. Yes, sir. You want to bring out one other item while you're up here? Something that hasn't been brought out before. Or you want to let it go at that?
Well, wait, just throw me under the bus. Talk about like, entrepreneurship.
All right.
Entrepreneurship.
Very good. Who spelled it, by the way?
Me.
Good job. Good job. Give you a plus for that.
Thank you.
What does it mean to you? If you know how to spell it, you must know what it means.
So an entrepreneur comes up with something, creates something. And yesterday we talked about entrepreneurship and how that private entrepreneurship progresses America, as Dr. Folsom said. When Americans take entrepreneurship and individualism into their own hands, America goes like this, and when the government tries to run the show, it goes like that. So.
And why do you think that is? What is it about entrepreneurship that makes society come better? Go back to music. What makes the entrepreneurs that do music better than a government-created institution?
When you take control of something, you have pride in it, correct? I think everyone would start something and want to do it because they like it and they have pride and they want to better it. So, for example, when Steve Jobs was working in his garage, he was trying to compete with everybody else in the world, and he was trying to progress his own company, being an entrepreneur and make technology that was affordable to everyone. And so when he gave his computers to colleges for free, he was trying to individualize his own computer, which then furthered into what Apple is today.
Good. It's just inner drive. Thank you, Thomas. Thank you very much.
I'll reinforce that. To reinforce that part about entrepreneurship, and I know you all agree with this analogy as well, if we divided this class into the people who were getting A's, B's, C's, and D's, and F's, a liberal might say the person to get into college, for example, to have a successful career, people up here in the front row, they don't need the A+. You could give them just the A-, and we're going to help Kelly and the people in the back row and give them, instead of an F, maybe a D+. And then, you know, you extend the argument, maybe they don't really need an A-, they could be a B, and let's move everybody up to a C. And pretty soon, you would, based on a socialist point of view or big government point of view, everybody would be getting C's automatically. What would happen? You'd stop trying. You wouldn't cram the night before, right? I mean, you wouldn't. If you're going to get a C, no matter what, you're going to do it. So the overall output of the group would go way down. Because what difference does it make? There would still be some people that would still try to strive to do the absolute best, but there'd be other people saying, it doesn't make any difference. I'm going to get a C. I have one son that never seemed in high school to study any of the subjects that he was supposed to study, but he was reading, he was doing other things, but he just wasn't doing his subjects. It would be that kind of mentality that one of my sons had, because he probably felt he could get the teacher to give him at least a passing grade, which is about what he did. He eventually went on to Hillsdale, and he got into Hillsdale, and late in the discussion of his time at Hillsdale, his friends were saying that it had the highest GPA of any class coming in. I think the average was over 3.5, equivalent to 3.5. And Tom looked at his fellow classmates and said, I'm the only one here in the school that could double his grade point average from high school to college. They all thought he was joking, but it actually was a true story. So he kind of had that mentality. Our final group, group five. We have less guys. Who's representing this group? Now, you've got a big job because there's a couple of big issues that are still out there. Free markets and Reaganomics, I'm not going to let you cover because it's been free market's been touched somewhat.
Well, sir, you want less government and strong national defense is one of the things I was...
You really wanted to bring out?
Yes, sir.
All right, well, go for it.
So strong national defense is like we have this great country, and the stronger, the better our military is. So we want to protect it from people who want our land. We have oil, we have great jobs here, and a strong national defense would just be able to protect us and help other countries also in need. So
you think by the fact that we're strong, other people are going to try to knock us off number one position?
Yes, sir.
That usually happens, right, in life? People go after number one. Why does Avis try harder? Because they want to knock off Hertz, right?
Yes, sir.
That is human nature, right? People want to be the top dog almost all the time. Sure. Choose another issue.
We need less government and more personal freedom like it used to be. The government was run by us, just us civilians, and we were in control. Now Wall Street. Now we have to pay taxes for everything. Abortion is even sometimes pushed upon people. Like,
okay, so no one else has hit that so far. That's a big issue. You don't have it on your list, but abortion you mentioned. What's the conservative position on that?
Well, as Christians, abortion is definitely murder. And so...
It's definitely taking a life, right?
Yes, it is. It's taking
murder,
a life.
Murder it's means like, intentionally taking a life, and you're probably doing that if you agree to an abortion, but there may be some people involved in it. But what's the core conservative position? It's pro-life, right?
Yes, sir.
What does that mean? Why you say less government, but why would right to life be an issue and stopping people from having abortions be less government?
Well, because the
put you on the spot, Joe, aren't I?
Yeah. The if the government had a choice, I think it would pick. If the government had a complete choice over what we did, it would probably pick abortion and maybe pick a certain type of...
But you have somewhat of the answer when you said less government. You didn't say no government, right?
Less government.
Less government and limited government. What does that mean? What did we endow our government to do? Mm-hmm. To protect what?
This power? More power.
What's the exact words they used? You have it. Say it. Right. That's why we start. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So we have less government, but the first function we said was to protect life. problem with abortion is you're taking an innocent human life. And it is a core conservative concept. If you're talking about conservative values and comparing it to the left likes to pretend they're helping the downtrodden. They're helping less fortunate people. There's very, the right to life and protecting the vulnerable unborn is totally inconsistent with what they claim they're for. Now look, you're gonna have fellow classmates that have had an abortion. It's gonna happen. There hadn't been 60 million in the country without people that you know having an abortion. So you have to approach this with the Christian values, the Judeo-Christian values that we already talked about. But you wanna protect life. And one of the analogies I use to do this is one that sometimes resonates with the left. The left claims that they protect the environment in ways that we do not. And they, I'll give you a classic example. They made the American bald eagle an endangered species up until very recently when it finally revived enough and they didn't, they dropped it. They didn't just protect the American bald eagle. They didn't just make it illegal to kill the American bald eagle while you were hunting or you wanted to do something else with it. They protected the whole life cycle of the American bald eagle. They protected the nesting areas. They protected the eggs. So you do, so I sometimes, when I have spoken to high school students, I say we should do no less for the human species than we do for endangered species. We protect the whole life cycle. But it is a role not of no government, but as you said right at the outset, less government or limited government. Hmm. Any other point you want to bring out while you're up here?
I think that's pretty much it, sir.
Good. Thank you very much, Joe.
Thank you. Good to have you with us.
It's extremely important that you come away from being with fellow conservatives, understanding what the core principles of conservatism is all about, why you should be proud to protect core principles. I want to just quickly mention a couple others that were tied into what was said today. Freedom of speech. Freedom of speech is absolutely important. You're going to have to fight for it in college. You may already have to fight for it in high school. You don't give up freedom of speech when you go to the schoolhouse door. The Supreme Court ruled that in Tinker, which was a case about high school students. Your right to free speech should be unlimited. The liberals today, in every way possible, are trying to restrict it, trying to stop what you say freely speaking in the classroom, stop what you say in your private conversations, stop what you say in the public quadrangle on your college campuses. Jolie could tell you a story at when she was at the university or at Penn State at law school that they stopped her from passing out the Constitution in a free speech zone. So the knee-jerk reaction of liberals is to stop free speech. You have to protect free speech. It's a fundamental right. We didn't talk about the differences. There's two clauses in the First Amendment relating to religion. There's the prohibiting the federal government, Congress shall make no law, the federal government from establishing a national religion. What that meant to the founding fathers was very specific. 9 of the 13 states at one time had established state religions. They didn't want a national state religion. They had different viewpoints in different states. Most of them, of course, were Protestant, but they even had different denominations among Protestants. They didn't want to establish one national church that everyone had to financially support. That's basically a libertarian instinct. But they also added the free exercise clause. And the free exercise clause is to protect your expression of religious values. The left today will make it sound like they're champions of freedom of worship, as if that's what's protected by the First Amendment. But freedom of worship is not the same as free exercise, as it's used in the current debate, and you ought to know that. Freedom of worship to liberals like President Obama and Hillary Clinton means that you can go to church or synagogue for an hour a week or an hour and a half, whatever it might be, and you're free to do pretty much what you want to do there, although the IRS doesn't allow pastors and that to say things from the pulpit that might infringe on politics. So they're even infringing on that. But essentially, that's freedom of worship. according to liberals. And liberals will say they're for freedom of worship. Free exercise of religion, which is actually the constitutional right that is protected, allows you to exercise your religious beliefs in every facet of your life. Now, there may be times when you potentially infringe on someone else's, and those would have to be adjudicated. But essentially, you have the right under the Free Exercise Clause of the First Amendment. Free speech, free exercise. These are rights that are under assault in high schools across the country today, and they're surely going to be under assault when you get to college. These are principles worth fighting for. These are principles worth believing in. You did a great job of presenting them yourselves. I appreciate the thought that you put into it. Appreciate you being here with us this weekend, and hope we can always be of help to you in the days ahead. Thank you very much.